The Megillah that we read on Shavuos is Megillas Rus. And the Lashon of Chazal about Megillas Rus is that the essence of the Megillah is Chesed. Megillas Rus en ba lo iser ve lo heter, lo tuma ve lo tara, ve lama nichtiva le lamet chaschar gomlei chasadim. That what we come and what we learn and what we gain from Megillas Rus is the understanding of the Midah of Chesed. And the question that I always had that bothered me for years was, why Chesed? If you talk about Mamad Har Sinai, if you talk about Matan Torah, if you're talking about our connection with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I would think that the Megillah that we're going to read would be a Megillah that would surround around the Midah of Emes, something to do with Nitzchias, something to do with truth, something to do with the unbelievable power that Torah has. Why Chesed out of all the Midos in this world? And the second question that I would like to ask is actually about a minhag. But just in understanding, the minhagim in Klal Yisrael are the ones that give us the taste, the flavor. If we want to tap in to what is the essence of a certain yontif, what are we supposed to walk out with? Go check the minhagim. Those are the ones that are revealing to us something a little bit more hidden about what we're supposed to really get out of the yontif. So one of the minhagim on Shavuos is to eat milchik, to eat things that are dairy, but they're also supposed to be sweet. And the makor for it, the source for it, is the pasuk in Shir HaShirim. Dvash v'chalav tachas l'shonech. In other words, when we talk about the words of Torah, it's supposed to be like honey and milk mixed together. And again, it needs a little bit of an understanding. We're talking about Matan Torah. We're talking about where HaKadosh Baruch Hu revealed himself as a king and we are his servants. We're talking about the fact that we chose to have a certain relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu and accepted upon ourselves the yoke of 613 mitzvahs. Why is the minhag, the statement of it, honey and milk mixed together? So in order to make some sense out of it, I would like just to give one very quick introduction. And that is that when we talk about, by Chazal, in any form or kind, that they refer to objects, places, numbers, anywhere in anything, in any of the psukim, the understanding is that the object in the physical world is just a manifestation or a reflection of something ruchni, of something higher. And therefore, the question that we need to ask ourselves is, what is the essence of milk? What is the essence of honey? And what in the world are we trying to make a statement about when we mix the two together and we eat them on Shavuos? So the place where I think everybody is familiar with the understanding of milk and honey together, and for the sake of time, I'm going to skip going through all the different places in Tanakh where it's mentioned, is actually in the Pasuk that talks about the Shevach of Eretz Yisrael. When we are discussing what is so unbelievable about Eretz Yisrael, the Pasuk, if I'm not mistaken, 36 times mentions Eretz Zavat Chalav Udvash, the land in which we have an abundance of milk and honey mixed together. And the interesting piece is as following. I grew up here in Eretz Yisrael, and there is a certain Lashon of Chazal about this Pasuk, and I once asked some of my friends, and they all agreed. We all grew up with this Lashon of a Gemara. I think I heard it since I was most probably in kindergarten till I reached the end of high school. And I remember that every year when the teacher would quote it, it's most probably in Sefer HaTodah, and that's why it's one of the easier ones that teachers have access to. It always bothered me. But I could never put my finger on what was actually bothering me till I got a little bit older. The Lashon of Chazal is as follows, that we had a Tana that was in the north of Eretz Yisrael. If I'm not mistaken, it was even in a place called Sipori. And he saw over there a goat that was eating from a fig tree. And the Lashon of Chazal is that the figs were so luscious that the honey from the figs was dripping on the floor, and the goat got so filled with milk from eating from those figs that the milk of the goat actually was pouring onto the floor, and on the floor there was a mixture of the milk from the goat and the honey from the figs, and the Tana said, this is what the Torah meant when it said Eretz Zavat Chalav Udvash. In other words, if I want a place that actually manifests what was the meaning, what was the shevach, what was the praise for Eretz Yisrael on Eretz Zavat Chalav Udvash, here it is. And as I said again, for years, it actually bothered me. And I'll explain why. If you would tell me that a Tana walked around the entire Eretz Yisrael, and he saw that every person in their backyard had either a fig tree or a date tree, and therefore he had an abundance of honey, and he had either a cow or a goat that used to give him a tremendous amount and abundance of milk. And he walked around and he saw the people there, I don't know what, for breakfast, for lunch, for supper, or throughout the entire day, they constantly have a tremendous amount of milk and honey. And say to me, that is the praise that the Pasuk meant. We're saying, Eretz Zavat Chalav Udvash, I can hear it. I would still need an understanding, but at least I could hear it. But to tell me that there was one Tana that was once in the north of Eretz Yisrael and saw one goat eating from one fig tree, and on that the Pasuk is praising Eretz Yisrael, just doesn't make any sense. And therefore, I would like to make a clarification. What the Tana did not mean to say that this is what the Pasuk meant in the literal sense out of it. The Tana was actually learning from there three things. As far as we're concerned, we're going to relate to two out of the three. And the two out of the three that he actually learned from is that the milk we're talking about is goat milk, not, let's say, cow milk or sheep milk, which would most probably be more common in any way, form, or kind. And the second thing is that the Pasuk does not mean milk separately and honey separately, but the Pasuk actually means when the milk and the honey mix together. I repeat again, what the Tana is telling us is two very important pieces of how do we read this combination of chalav and dvash. One is that milk is goat milk, and the second one is that it's milk and honey mixed together. Not milk separately and honey separately, but the combination of the two together. And let's go and learn a little bit more. What in the world are we talking about? So the first piece I would like to explain is actually a chiddush that I came about when I was in the hospital when I gave birth to my last daughter. She's already 14 years old, so it's quite a long time ago. I have cesareans, I should say, Baruch Hashem, that there is that option, and therefore I'm zoicha to have children. But normally, after I have a cesarean, I'm actually very, very schwach, and my iron is very low. And in this particular case, two interesting things happened when I was in the hospital. One was that I was having a very, very hard time with nursing. She just wasn't getting filled from my milk in any way. And there was a Yushami lady sitting next to me that kept on trying to convince me that I should give my daughter goat milk. And she kept on telling me, goat milk is the most similar to mother's milk. Give your daughter or supplement your daughter, not with any of the supplements, but give her goat milk. The second thing that happened was that my iron was very low, and I happen to not like to take iron pills. I don't feel like they help me. They cause me certain things to make me uncomfortable. And the nurse was trying to convince me to take them. And she kept on saying to me the same sentence. She said to me, listen, if your iron in your blood is not going to be good, your milk will not going to be good. Because, and this I also know from Lashonos of Chazal, but it's true medical, the understanding is that mother's milk, which means it could be by a human or by any of the animals, is the blood of the mother that becomes milk. The Lashon of Chazal is dam nechar venefa chalav. It's the blood of the mother that turns into being milk. And therefore she was saying to me, listen, if your blood does not have enough iron, your milk will not be good. And that's the reason why your baby is not getting satisfied from what you're giving her. And as I was listening to those two pieces, suddenly something clicked in my brain. Do you know why goat milk is the most similar to mother's milk? Do you know why? Because the blood of the goat is the most similar to the blood of a human being. Where do we know this from? Mechiras Yosef. By Mechiras Yosef, the Pasuk mentions as following, that after they sold Yosef, they wanted to present in front of Yaakov as if an animal actually attacked Yosef. and they took his article of clothing, his kutones pasim, and they dipped it in the blood of a goat. And Rashi makes a comment, why a blood of a goat? Because a blood of an animal and a blood of a human being do not look the same. And therefore, if they would dip it in the blood of any animal, Yaakov would be able to realize it's not the blood of Yosef. But the blood of the goat is extremely similar to the blood of a human being, and therefore Yaakov could think that it's a blood of a person, the blood of Yosef. But now go one more step. If the blood of the goat is the most similar to the blood of a human being, then the milk of the goat would be the most similar to the milk of a human being, because the milk is the blood that becomes milk. So in other words, when the pasuk is talking about chalav and we say goat milk, really what it means is mother's milk. What is unique about mother's milk? Or what is the statement that we're trying to make when we're trying to say mother's milk? So I need over here two very quick introductions in the understanding of what's happening every single year by Shavuos, or what are we meant to be our approach in the understanding. When we talk about the fact that Klal Yisrael said, Na'aseh v'nishma by Mamad Har Sinai, and in a sense, every single one of us, every single year, needs to say, Na'aseh v'nishma when we come to the Yontif of Shavuos. And the question is obvious. How could you say Na'aseh before you actually heard what is it all about? And I heard a beautiful explanation on the matter. There's a little bit of a common mistake that we have in the understanding of our keeping of Torah mitzvahs. And maybe I'll say the following mashal. Imagine for a second someone living in Eretz Yisrael, they own or they have a large family, and it is very difficult for the mother who has a lot of kids, who is also working, to get around to do all the errands from place to place in buses. Taxis are very expensive, and to go around in buses and schlepping everything that you have to schlep is very complicated. So there is a relative that is in Chutz La'aretz that has money and wants to help them out. So what they do is they come to Eretz Yisrael and they buy a car. And they say to them, listen, throughout the entire year, you could use the car for free. We're more than happy. Enjoy it. Twice a year when we come to Eretz Yisrael, for Sukkot and for Pesach, for those 2 weeks each time that we come, a week and a half, 2 weeks, the car needs to be by us. So now let's talk about this person. Obviously, the time that you need the car most probably the most is before Pesach and before Sukkot, when you have a lot of errands. But when this person comes and he wants his car back, no one has a complaint. No one could say, how in the world are you taking back the car? Because it's very clearly understood the car belongs to them. They were so nice and let me use the car the rest of the year. Avada, the minute they need the car or they want the car, I have to give it back to them. It's not mine, it's theirs. And a little bit, that's our understanding. Our life is not ours. Anything and everything that we have in this world, from the most smallest thing to the biggest thing, does not belong to us. It belongs to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So therefore, if HaKadosh Baruch Hu says to us, you know what, normally and most of the time you could enjoy it and have it, but on these specific times I'm saying, no, the life is mine, you need to do what I want, or you need, quote unquote, to give it back to me. We can't have a complaint. It's not ours. It doesn't belong to me. But the truth is, this is a mistake in understanding. This is not what Torah mitzvahs is all about. It's not that it's not mine, it belongs to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, therefore he could dictate for me what to do. I mean, it is true, but that's not the right understanding of what Torah mitzvahs is all about. So let me give a second mashal. It's not a great mashal. The next step of it is much better, but I still want to tell it over to make a certain point clear. Imagine that you have a child here in Eretz Yisrael that grew up in a poor family that never, ever, ever, ever went out to eat. To the most that this child is aware of is he has most probably bread and some cheese and some egg and not much more. And then he has a birthday and a relative would like to take him out for the birthday. But the parents do not want him to go to any place that's not proper, and therefore they are agreeing on that he could take him to a falafel store. For those that know Eretz Yisrael a little bit, Falafel Ben Yaakov on Shmuel Navi is an excellent falafel store. So they walk into the falafel store and this child, he's 6 years old, he orders a falafel and then he orders also French fries. Now, if you know what happens when you go to a store and you order French fries, you get with it a few packages of small ketchup. So the person hands him a few packages of ketchup. And the child gets so excited and he asks this person, is the ketchup mine? And he says, yes. Could I do with it what I want? He says, yes. Is it for me? He says, yes. Anyway, they sit down to eat and he pulls out the French fries and the child takes the ketchup and he puts it in his pocket. So the person says to him, no. Take the ketchup, open it up, put it on your plate, dip the French fries in the ketchup. And the child gets all upset and the child says, I don't understand. Is the ketchup mine or not mine? If it's mine, I can do with it whatever I want. Why are you telling me what to do? And the person says to him, no, I'm not telling you what to do. But the best way to eat French fries is to eat them with ketchup. If you want to get the most out of ketchup or the most out of French fries, it doesn't taste good if you eat it separately. It tastes good if you dip the French fries in the ketchup. What's the point? What am I trying to say? Now, again, the mashal is not so good because there are people that don't like French fries with ketchup. But let's assume for a second that French fries with ketchup taste way, way better than French fries without ketchup. You know what the understanding is? When HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us Torah and mitzvahs, you know what HaKadosh Baruch Hu is saying to us? Kinderlach, the best way to live in this world is to do Torah and mitzvahs. This is what's going to give you a certain gadlus, a certain romimus. This is what's going to elevate you. This is what's going to make you the best you could have. If you're coming into this world, and for the 70, 80, or 120 years you're going to be in this world, and you want to get the maximum out of this world, this is the best way that you should do it. The point of mitzvahs is not a Kodesh Baruch Hu taking away from us. It's not a Kodesh Baruch Hu saying mine and therefore I don't want you to have. It's the exact opposite. When we said Naaseh v'nishma, we said we know HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants our best. We know HaKadosh Baruch Hu is telling us, like a doctor is telling someone or a nutritionist is telling someone, this is the best way for you to live in a ruchnia sense. If you want to get the most out of this world, this will give you the best way to get it out of this world. If I want to go back to Lashonos of Chazal, Chazal compare Torah and mitzvahs to actually nutrition. The same way the physical body needs nutrition in order to survive. And the better the nutrition is, the stronger we are, the healthier we are. And if a person doesn't have proper nutrition or doesn't eat or drink properly, then chas v'shalom, he can become very sick, very weak, and sometimes he won't be able to even last. The understanding is that Torah and mitzvahs are the nutrition of our neshama. That's why the letter that the month of Sivan corresponds to is the letter Zayin, Miloshon of Mazon. But here comes a very good question. What mazon are we going to compare Torah to? You could compare it to, let's say, bread. But bread is carbohydrates. It doesn't give me the protein. It doesn't give me the vitamins. It also doesn't give me drink. You could actually compare it to, let's say, water or wine. But again, it doesn't give me the food. I'm lacking. I'm missing. The statement of Torah mitzvahs is that it's everything and anything that I need. But try to find a good mashal. You'll have a very hard time. You know what the best mashal is? Really the right mashal is? Mother's milk to a baby. Because mother's milk to a baby is anything and everything the baby needs. It's the food, it's the vitamins, it's the protein, it's the carbohydrate, it's the drink. It's whatever the baby needs at whatever stage he is. The mother milk is exactly what the baby needs. Should I use a stronger statement? The mother milk is the lifeline of this baby. If he has mother's milk, then he could live, or anything that's like mother's milk. But if he doesn't get the mother's milk, or if chas v'shalom, you give him something else besides mother's milk, when he's a little baby, even if it's something that, let's say, is very healthy, say, poor baby only has mother's milk, let's give him a carrot, let's give him, I don't know what, when he's little, it can actually be dangerous. The mashal is chalav Torah and mitzvot are our mother's milk. It's our entire nutrition. It's our lifeline. Kiyem chayenu ve'orach yameinu. I want to say a sentence for a second just to talk about a time period. I imagine that it's true the same in America. It is beautiful here in Eretz Yisrael. You know, in this time period of the Corona, when everything was taken away from us, the shuls are being closed, the yeshivas are being closed, and I'm not even talking about everything else in the matter, but I'm talking about important ruchnias things. And the only things that we are doing are things that are essential, things that our life depends upon, like a pharmacy, like actually going to a store to buy food. You know what's so beautiful by Klal Yisrael? Listen to all the shiurim that are still going and all the chavrusas that are still going and the minyanim that are being done outside, obviously properly safe. But you know what you're actually seeing? You're seeing Klal Yisrael saying essential is keeping Torah mitzvot. Essential is learning Torah. Essential is davening to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Again, we have a mitzvah of Nishmartem Me'od HaNafshoseichem, and I'm talking about within those boundaries. But listen to all the ads. See all the ads. See all the shiurim online. See all the people that are coming and listening so much. You know what we're actually making a statement? It's our mother's milk. It's our lifeline. But I want to go one more step. What is dvash? So normally when you talk about dvash, dvash is the mashal for the Yetzirah. Talking about something that is sweet, that's not behechrech nutritious, and therefore in more than one case, the Yetzirah is actually compared to the dvash. But here we have again a mistake. There's a certain understanding that we have that actually Torah mitzvot are an obligation. And you know something? I don't want to lose out in the next world, or I don't want to lose out in this world. The Eivish Day is stronger than me, and whatever the case is, so therefore I don't have a choice. I have to give up on all the things that are sweet and are good. You know what it reminds me a little bit? When you go on a diet and you want to be healthy, and you actually want to be MSB, fit into a certain outfit or whatever the case is. So really the understanding is chocolate tastes very good, ice cream tastes very good, all this spread over here, but I have to give it up. I don't have a choice if I want to be healthy or if I want to be skinny. I still remember when I was in sixth grade, I started a diet for the first time, and my mother told me the golden rule of a diet. You know what the golden rule of a diet is? Depressing, if you want to say it. It's if it tastes good, it is fattening. That was her rule. And therefore, the understanding is that you have to battle between, do I want something that tastes good, or do I want to look good? So a little bit, we say, what can we do? We're from Yidden. We know there's an Eibishter. So therefore, they have a good time in their life. We can have all the good time because we know that there is a Kodesh Baruch Hu that's stronger than us. And here comes the mistake. You're right that the starting point is chalav. It's my nutrition. It's my lifeline. But just get it clear, it's also dvash. It's chalav mixed with dvash. When we talk about Yiddishkeit, the lashon is mitukim midvash v'nofet sufin. They're sweeter than dvash. You know, when you talk about, or Pinchas brings down, what's the first mitzvah that you teach a child? To kiss a sitter. You know why? Because what you're teaching him is that Torah is sweet, that doing mitzvos is ultimate of the ultimate of pleasure that you could have. Just in Ruchnias, a lot of times it takes a drop of time. We have to disconnect from certain things and give us a little bit of work till we taste it. But anyone that ever tasted a proper doing of chesed, a proper davening, a proper form of learning something, knows that there's nothing sweeter in the world than doing mitzvos. There's no something sweeter in the world than having a kirvas elokim. When we start to teach a child to learn, you put a honey of the letters of the aleph beis. What's the message that we want to teach him? That Torah is sweet, that kirvas elokim is sweet, that it's gishmak to be a yid. You know what the point of Simchas Torah is, which is the end of the Yomim Noraim? Simchas Torah is not just chashivas for Torah, it's not just ahava for Torah. Simchas Torah is making the statement that Torah makes me dance, Torah makes me happy, Torah makes me excited, Torah fills my life up with joy. I would like to say the sentence a little bit strong. There's a certain yid, and I once heard a description of them, of a group of people that are from, that know that there is HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that really are scared or worry about, you know, their relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but the Hagdara of them was that they have 613 problems. In other words, they really want to enjoy this world, they really want to have a great time in this world, Elamai, they have 613 problems that they need to figure out how to go about, or how to avoid, or how to make sure that they don't lose out too much of the matter. And I want to say that unfortunately, a little bit, it came into ours also. I remember a few years ago, someone told me over, I don't know why she told it to me because it was very stupid, that she went for an hotel for Pesach. And she was bragging about the food in the hotel. And her words were that the food was so good that if there wouldn't have been matzah on the table, you wouldn't have been able to know that it is Pesach. And you know what my reaction was? Nebuch. I never knew that Pesach was a problem that I'm trying to avoid. I never knew that Pesach was something that I have to try to outsmart HaKadosh Baruch Hu and show him that I could not eat chametz, but actually you wouldn't be able to tell that I'm not eating chametz. I said to her, Pesach by me is beautiful, is wonderful. It's a schos, it's a privilege, it's a present. I want that you walk into my house, that you should feel Pesach. I want you that you should see Pesach. I want to tap in to the most that Pesach can give me. It's not a problem that I'm trying to avoid. It's not I'm saying, okay, I would like to enjoy the food to the utmost. What could I do? I don't have a choice. I have to keep a mitzvah, so let's try to outsmart it in any way, form, or kind. I want Pesach. I love Pesach. I chap that mitzvos are essential. They're my lifeline. They build me up. They give me a certain level of satisfaction, and they give me a certain sweetness that nothing else in the world will actually give me. And that's what the minhag of Shavuos is. When we come to Shavuos, you could come into Shavuos saying, it's a yoke, I don't have a choice. You could be an emes ha'maimin and know that there's Torah mitzvos, and know that there's a Ribbono Shel, and know that there's Olam Hazeh and Olam Haba. But your whole approach is, it's a yoke, I don't have a choice, it's a problem. I really need to avoid as much as I can. Or you could come in and say, Dvash v'chalav tachas l'shonech. It's my lifeline. Kiyem chayenu v'orach yameinu. It's my nutrition. It's my mother's milk. It builds me. It's my dvash. It's the sweetest thing that I can actually have in this world. You could come in and chap, what a privilege I have that the Eibishter shared with me his Torah u'mitzvos and gave me the ability to get the utmost that I could have out of this world. And that's why the Megillah that we read on Shavuos is Megillas Rus, because the statement we want to make is that the biggest chesed HaKadosh Baruch Hu did with us is that he shared with us Torah mitzvos. He gave us our lifeline. He gave us our nutrition. He gave us the best, sweetest experience that you could have in this world. And that's why when we say in davening, Atza Bechartanu Mikol Ha'amim, that's Pesach. Ahavta Osanu, that Shavuos, the unbelievable manifestation of the Ahava that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has to Klal Yisrael. How much he loves us, how much he wants us to get the most and the utmost of this world is Ahava Rabba Avtanu Hashem Elokeinu. And how did it manifest itself? Torah u'mitzvos, chukim u'mishpatim, otanu limadeta. So let's come into Pesach, into Shavuos, saying to ourselves, 613 presents, 613 treasures. This is my lifeline, HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Say to the Eibishter, thank you, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that you gave me the most precious present that you could have actually given me, that you showed me the best way to live in this world. Chalav as my nutrition and my lifeline. Dvash as it being sweet. And dvash on its own, when it's sweetness of Olam Hazeh, you could handle very little of it. But when it's chalav and dvash together, when it's ruchnias hanas, when it's the sweetness that come out of a kirvas Elokim, then dvash v'chalav is endless. You could have as much as you can. And I'm going to give every single one of you a bracha that you should be zoicha be'emes to realize and to chap how essential it is, how much it builds us, and be zoicha to taste the sweetness of Kirvas Elokim. A good Yom Tov.